I want to welcome everyone on behalf of the Ninth Circuit Public Information and Community Outreach Committee, or PICO, to this program honoring the students who participated in this year's Civics Contest and recognizing the winners in the essay and video categories. My name is Haywood Gilliam. I'm a district judge for the Northern District of California and a member of the PICO committee, and I'm standing in today for our committee chair, Judge John Cronstadt, who couldn't join us at the conference today because of an important family commitment. This year marks the eighth time that the contest has been held on a circuit-wide basis, and our entrants continued a proud tradition of submitting excellent, thoughtful work. The theme of this year's contest was the 28th Amendment to the United States Constitution. What should our next amendment be? Now, as you can imagine just from hearing that sentence, that is a challenging, thought-provoking, and weighty topic for high school students to take on. And that may be even more true, given that the last amendment to our Constitution was all the way back in 1992, well before today's high schoolers were born. This year's contest asks students to think about what they see as today's most pressing issues and propose a constitutional amendment to address one of them, supporting their argument with historical and legal examples. And so not only did entrants have to come up with a good idea and explain why they thought their amendment was necessary, they also had to think practically about how they would go about getting it ratified. Now, I'm very pleased to report that the students of our circuit were more than up to that large challenge. Circuit-wide, 966 students submitted essays, and 86 submitted video entries. There were at least three entries from every district in the circuit, with four districts submitting over 100 entries. Each district submitted its top entries for consideration at the circuit level, and then the top 12 essays and 10 videos advanced to the final round of judging. Now, as we know, encouraging our young people to think about and wrestle with these big ideas is critical to nurturing the informed public on which our democratic system depends. And learning to develop an argument and support it with solid evidence and sound reasoning is not just important for lawyers or future lawyers. Instead, it is a skill that enables all of us to communicate with each other in a way that is civil, fact-based, and mutually respectful. And that is true even when the issues are momentous, and even when, and perhaps especially when, we honestly disagree on the merits. These are some of the goals of the Civics Contest, and we hope that every student who wrote an essay or produced a video came away with a deeper understanding of our Constitution and the foundation it provides for the rule of law in our society. So all of this is to say, Liam and Luke, who will be joining us here on the podium in a bit, you can take justifiable pride in standing out in such a robust and high quality pool of entries, and we're delighted to be here with you this afternoon to recognize and celebrate your accomplishments. It's not every day that you get the chance to be saluted by a United States Supreme Court Justice, and we are very grateful that Justice Kagan has taken the time to join us for today's program. So to start our program, I'm honored to introduce our circuit's Chief Judge, Mary Murguia. Chief Judge Murguia is very well acquainted with the PICO Committee's work, having served on the committee from 2013 to 2017, and she has long worked to support civics education for young people in our circuit. As just one example, Chief Judge Murguia founded the CourtWorks program in partnership with the District of Arizona and the Sandra Day O'Connor College of Law at Arizona State University. That program provides hundreds of eighth graders the opportunity to reenact an actual court case in mock trials, assuming the roles of judges, jurors, prosecutors, defense attorneys, defendants, and witnesses. CourtWorks aims to introduce students to constitutional principles and the judicial system and encourages them to think about careers in the legal field. And so we're especially grateful to Chief Judge Murguia for being with us today for this celebration of civics education, a mission that she has done so much to advance in our circuit. Chief Judge Murguia.
Thank you for that kind introduction. It's really a pleasure to be here. I try to attend this every year because I was on the PICO committee. I know the hard work that they do, and I just want to take a moment to acknowledge and thank you all for that work. a lot of districts, you know, either through their bankruptcy courts, the magistrate judges, the district courts, do so much throughout the year to reach out to the community through this form of civic sort of education. And it takes a lot of work. There's no extra pay. They are very busy with their duties, but it's so valuable when the courts are opening up the doors for another reason other than litigation, and to really, especially during these times when the country's so divided on things and issues and topics, that we reach out, you know, to the community, especially to kids, and expose them to the importance of our justice system and our democracy. And I'm so proud of the work that we do at the Ninth Circuit, and that's because of the work that every district does in promoting civics education. So I know it's an ongoing endeavor and meaningful undertaking, and that's why our federal judiciary and I, as chief of the circuit, am committed to continue our efforts to promote public confidence in the judiciary, both through our rulings and through civic outreach. I'm truly delighted that so many young people in our circuit answered the call for submission and feel honored to personally congratulate this year's winners. We value your ideas, thoughtful essays, and creative video submissions. So on behalf of our circuit, I want to congratulate the first place winners, Liam Hutchison from Punahou School, Honolulu, Hawaii. Your essay proposing a constitutional amendment that would establish independent redistricting commissions for congressional and state legislative districts was clear, instructive, and really quite inspiring. And Luke Blue from Mount Spokane High School in Meade, Washington, your video suggesting an amendment to the Constitution that ends the treatment of corporations as people was creative and included historical facts with impressive precision. Again, congratulations to both of you. Well done, and thank you for your civic engagement.
So the next part of the program is the presentation of the awards and checks and the recognition of our winners, including the winners from the District of Oregon, District of Central District of California. So starting with the essay contest, the first place winner, as we've discussed, and the recipient of a $3,000 check, is Liam Hutchison, who I'll ask to come up in a minute. Liam graduated recently from Punahou High School in Honolulu. He's joined here today by his mother, Nancy, and I understand that they had an arduous trip to make it here to join us. So we're so glad that you made it, and so glad to recognize your excellent work. As Justice Kagan mentioned, Liam's essay is in your materials, the book that you have there. And the very mild-mannered title of the essay is "The Evil Gerrymander and America's United Response." Hedging, a lot of hedging, a lot of uncertainty. And I'll just read you the first paragraph of the essay. "The principle of one person, one vote, established by the Supreme Court in the 1960s, encapsulates a fundamental aspect of voting. Every vote is equal. However, when politicians redraw districts to unfairly advantage a particular party, this principle becomes one person, one vote, no choice. This practice is called gerrymandering, and it is a persistent threat to American democracy that must be nationally addressed." And I really commend everyone to read the entirety of Liam's essay and the materials, because it is thoughtful, it takes a strong position, it's passionate, and it's extremely well argued. And so I'd like to ask Liam to come up and receive your certificate and your check. Now, with respect to the video portion of the contest, our first place winner and also the recipient of a $3,000 check is Luke Blue. Luke is a rising senior at Mount Spokane High School in Spokane, and he's joined here today by his father, Stephen, and I think he was planning to come with his cousin as well. I won't tell you any more what Luke's video is about. We'll let you see for yourself if we could play the video.
Are corporations people? Some say yes, others say no. It's a highly debated topic within American political society, and I am here to, in my own personal words, lay that question to rest and give a solution for all Americans from sea to shining sea. I'm Luke Blue, and this is my proposal for the 28th Amendment of the United States of America.
And that corporations are not people.
In my view, a corporation is not a person.
Corporations are people, my friend.
Of course they are. Everything corporations earn ultimately goes to people.
Governor Romney, corporations are not people.
It's 1952, and the post-war economic boom in our country has begun. Presidential nominee Dwight D. Eisenhower premieres the first ever political television advertisement. Now, why is this important? Because television changed the way the political landscape worked. This opened up a whole new world of corporations who could combine their knowledge of the marketing and advertising world with politics, and they could funnel endless amounts of money into the politicians they wanted elected to office. Eventually, election spending started to soar, and Congress saw the issue. In 1971, they passed the Federal Election Campaign Act, or FECA for short. This bill established the Federal Election Commission, which regulated political campaign spending and fundraising. Specifically, it limited 1. How much money a person could give to a political candidate, and 2. How much money candidates could spend on their campaign. So let's say The Rock runs for president. The first part of the bill limited how much money he could receive from other people to support his run, and the second part of the bill limited how much money he could spend himself to support his run. All right. So good, no problems, Will.
Objection!
In 1976, a case named Buckley v. Vallejo was sent to the Supreme Court to challenge FECA. They claimed that money equals speech and that corporations equal people, and people have the right to free speech. It was decided upon by the Supreme Court that the second part of FECA was unconstitutional, while the first part was fine, meaning that you still couldn't directly give a political candidate unlimited amounts of money, but now they could spend as much money as they wanted on themselves. And to get a loop through this hole, we have to use a little thing called hard versus soft money. Now that candidates could spend endless amounts of money, it's loophole time. Hard and soft money isn't like cash and coins, rather it's more like this. Hard money is the amount of money you directly give to a campaign, the thing that was capped by FECA. Soft money, however, is the amount of money you give to a campaign indirectly, say through a political party or interest group. That would then end up paying for the advertisements on said campaign's behalf. Whoa, hold on. Oh yeah, that's right, Congress is back, and this time they're passing the Bipartisan Campaign Reform Act, or BCRA for short. In layman's terms, it limited the amount of soft money someone could indirectly give to a campaign. It was passed in 2002. Finally, problem solved. No more. In 2010, the Supreme Court decided on another case, this time challenging BCRA. It was called Citizens United versus the FEC. You see, in 2008, Citizens United, a nonprofit corporation, wanted to release a documentary called Hillary the Movie. This violated BCRA, so Citizens United challenged BCRA itself. The Supreme Court narrowly sided with Citizens United, claiming that some parts of BCRA were unconstitutional and violated the free speech clause of the First Amendment. They also reaffirmed that corporations were in fact people. Now, how do we fix this? How do we stop this endless cycle of bill versus Supreme Court cases? Simple. Amendment. No bill, no one in Congress, and no judge can trump the United States Constitution. That's why I proposed the Saving American Democracy Amendment by Senator Sanders and Begich. This amendment would end the long-argued debate on if corporations were people with a firm no, and would give Congress and the states power to regulate and set limits on all election contributions by expenditures. This amendment is needed today to combat corporate tyranny over American elections and make them fair and freer for all candidates. I say that if money is speech, then speech is inherently unequal. And if I say that corporations are people, then not every man is created equal. As George Orwell's book Animal Farm stated best, all animals are equal, but some animals are more equal than others. Passing this amendment would be a monumental task, but it would be doable. First, multiple polls have shown that reducing the influence of big campaign donors is extremely popular, with 82% of Americans finding it very important or somewhat important. We would first give the amendment media publicity, bringing it into the mainstream and making it a hot topic debate issue. Second, we would write and demand to Congress that they immediately hold a proposal for the amendment, getting 2/3 of the support needed as well. As I stated, it was two congressmen who proposed this amendment in the first place, giving us a helping hand already. Third, once the amendment has been successfully proposed, we would hold a nationwide special state convention in all 50 states to decide on ratification. Using the convention method instead of the state legislature method would be more practical, as some states would have delegates elected by the people decide on the ratification of the amendment, thus making them far less prone to corporate lobbying, our biggest issue faced. Once the amendment was ratified, it would be in place, and the debate on if corporations were people would be over. Elections would be safer, fairer, and freer for all Americans, from California to the New York Island.
Again, very shy, very retiring take on the issues. Luke, if you would come forward and get your award. And we'd also like to recognize the winners from our host district, the District of Oregon, who are here with us this afternoon. And I'll ask the students to stand up as your name is called, and then if the audience would hold your applause until all the winners are introduced. Our first place essay winner from Oregon is Kate Stuckert, who is a recent graduate of Central High School in Portland, and she's here with her mother, Amy, and her father, Jeff. Kate. I had a really nice chance to chat with them at the last program. We were sitting at the same table. Our third place essay winner is a recent graduate of Cresswell High School in Cresswell, Jordan Rizdahl, and she's here with her mother, Lacey, and her brother, Lance. And the team of Josephine Emanuel Mitchell, a rising senior, and Sam Skolnick, a rising junior at Franklin High in Portland, are the first place video winners. Please join me in congratulating the District of Oregon winners. And I also understand that the Central District of California has a really great perk for the winners of its contest in that it traditionally awards them a trip to the circuit conference. And so we're very glad to recognize them as well. And again, if the students would please stand when your name is called, then I'll ask everyone to hold their applause. The first place video winners were the team of Diego Garcia and Alexander Carney, who are rising juniors at Orange County School of the Arts in Santa Ana. Diego's here with his mother, Marcia, and Alexander's with his father, Jeremy. And I understand that the first place essay winner, David Estrada, is unable to join because he's participating in a summer program at Georgetown, but I believe his father, who is the U.S. attorney for the Central District, may be here in his stead, E. Martin Estrada. If he's not here physically, I know he's here in spirit. All right, so the next part of our program is one of the highlights for those of us on the PICO committee. And that is we're doing a panel with some of the members of the committee and with Luke and Liam about their experience participating in contest as a conversation with some of the members of the committee. And so we'll be joined by Ninth Circuit Judge Ryan Nelson, Bankruptcy Judge Mary Jo Heston from the Western District of Washington, and Kelly Sager, who's a partner at Davis Wright Tremaine in Los Angeles. So I'll ask everyone to come forward now and then we'll have our panel discussion. So our first question for our winners is the most basic one, which is, what made each of you interested in the Ninth Circuit Civics Contest, and how did you find out about it? If Luke or Liam, you want to take that one first?
Is this thing on? needs.
You can hear me?
I think you might need to move it closer.
What about now?
Okay, too close. So I actually didn't find out about this on my own. I am a debate team member at my high school, and we don't have debate season for the second half of the semester. So she was just giving us random assignments, and she knew about this thing. So she basically made an assignment for us. Only two people did it, including me. The other person, it was a joke. But the reason why I was interested in this subject is because I have a huge interest for the political world, civics. I think it's something that the youth needs to be involved in much more. You look at polls, you look at voters, it's like voter turnout for people who are over 65 is really high, but then you look at the age group, what is it, like 18 to 25? It's like, it's not even half, I think. So I think that the youth need to get a lot more involved in civics, and I recognize this is perfect. I think it's great that they're pushing this on the high school students. Not even really pushing, just suggesting it. So I decided to give it a shot. I didn't expect to win. I thought maybe since, you know, Eastern Washington doesn't have that many people, might get third place or something. But then, you know, I think it was a letter in the mail or something telling me, or I think it was an email saying that I won the entire competition. Or no, I remember what happened, actually. Stanley Bastian, the chief judge of Eastern Washington, came onto a Zoom call in the middle of my class in sixth period and debate team and was like, yeah, you won.
Liam, how about you?
So I actually first heard about this contest last year from my AP US History teacher, Dr. Christensen. And she told us that she usually introduces the contest to every single APUSH class every semester, or I guess like every year. And I decided that I would just give it a shot because I didn't really know too much about civics. And I thought that the idea of free speech rights for students sounded like an interesting idea. And I wanted to learn more about it. So I started to do more research on that, and I got second place in the District of Oahu, and I was like, I really thought that my essay could definitely be greatly improved from that time. I was like, I was even surprised I made it that far. So then I decided to give it another chance this year and space out my research and writing much farther out from the actual deadline. So which is definitely a good idea that I recommend. And
paid off.
Yeah, so I mean, when I heard about this year's topic, I think that greatly drew me to it too, just the fact that you could propose any constitutional amendments, and I'm just very happy that I participated in it, and I'm glad that I was able to get to hear.
Absolutely.
One of the things that struck me, I was one of the judges for the video contest, and one of the things that struck me in looking at the 12 videos that were the circuit finalists was that every single one of them was choosing a different topic. It was not like everybody had sort of picked the same theme, but of course both our winners both picked election topics. So I'm curious for each of you to answer sort of what made you pick that particular topic? What inspired you to pick the constitutional amendment proposal that you picked? And either one of you can start. Sure, go ahead.
Well, I think that, and this is something that they mentioned, just as Bastian mentioned, that they started the idea for the 20th Amendment, what should the 20th Amendment be, because Roe versus Wade had been overturned last year. And so I was thinking, okay, then everybody's just going to make an amendment about abortion, you know, that's fine and all. But I thought I needed to come up with something more original and under-discussed topic. And I think something that is so under-discussed, and nothing's under-discussed in our country, but there are things that are over-discussed. I think we can all agree on that. But I think that the economy and wealth inequality is a very under-discussed issue in the country. It was a hot topic debate issue in 2016, but then not so much in the next election. Still a lot, but COVID was really the big thing then. So I was thinking maybe I should make something about the economy, something about wealth inequality, but what for an amendment? And then I remember Bernie Sanders and Mark Begich had proposed an amendment for the campaign finance reform, because recently, I think before that, Citizens United overturned BCRA. So I thought that that was a wonderful idea for an amendment, and also I didn't have to think too hard.
Yeah, so I feel like I spent almost as much time deciding on what amendment to write about as I did actually writing it. Maybe it was like, it took me like an entire month of just researching to actually find an amendment that I felt was good enough for me to be able to write about and be able to write about it well. Because there are so many proposed amendments. There's even like a resource I was using that shows thousands of amendments that have been proposed before but have never been passed. And so I even looked at Luke's amendments. I looked at so many different amendments, but gerrymandering was something that really struck me as something that was, it's an issue that both sides of the aisle, from Democrats to Republicans to independents, all care about and all think is something that should be addressed. And so, like I talked about in my essay, we already have a test for racial gerrymandering, which I said interplays between the Voting Rights Act and the Equal Protection Clause. But for partisan gerrymandering, we don't have anything. So it was just a little niche topic, and the idea of independent redistricting commissions was just something that I found really compelling research that really works to, you know, reduce partisanship and create competitive districts. And once I just chose the topic, the writing became easy for me because I really felt passionate about the topic.
Judge Heston, you want to go to your question?
Sure. So I'll start with you, Liam. What's the most interesting thing that you learned either about the Constitution or the amendment process through writing your essay?
Yeah, I think one major thing that stood out to me was just how difficult it is to actually amend our Constitution compared to many other constitutions in the world. And I even found some articles that were saying that our Constitution is considered to be the hardest Constitution to amend in the entire world. And that was just something that struck me as really surprising and interesting, but it makes sense because given the steep requirements that our founding fathers placed on actually making an amendment pass, it just shows the trend that there are less amendments being passed as time goes on. And the last amendment was passed in, it was 1992, right? And it just is getting harder and harder as time goes on because of the partisanship and the difficulty of passing the amendments. And I just found it really interesting that our amendments, that people have literally proposed making the amendment process easier just to be able to pass more amendments because they believe that the Constitution should be more of a living document. But of course, that's still a controversial issue. But it was just really interesting to look into why our amendment process is so difficult and, you know, the different sides on that issue.
What about you, Luke?
I think something I learned is the way that amendments could be ratified. I knew that I think 2/3 of states had to vote on it, or it was more than 25, and that, you know, a majority of Congress would have to approve. Like, I knew that, but I didn't know that you could also set up certain commissions and have almost sort of like elections, and that there were all these different types of ways that each individual state could decide on the person who would vote. Like, some of them would be elected, some of them would be appointed, and there were so many other different systems. I didn't realize it was that diverse until after researching it. So I thought about that very carefully and how I would actually get the amendment passed, or how we would get the amendment passed.
Is there anything that either of you think about differently now than you did when you started? Is there something that surprised you that you learned as you went through the process of preparing your entry?
Yeah, I think something that surprised me about gerrymandering in general is that, like, I found an article that was talking about how people or presidents from Reagan to Obama have all supported measures against gerrymandering, but the ways that they actually wanted to fight partisan gerrymandering differed, because some decided to include wording in the Constitution that would slightly change some parts of the Constitution just to make so that state legislatures can't gerrymander districts. But I decided to do the independent, or sorry, I decided to do the independent redistricting commissions, because out of all of the solutions for gerrymandering, I just found that to be the most compelling after I started to learn more about it.
How about you, Luke?
I think something that actually really surprised me was how many amendment proposals and how many ideas are unbelievably popular with us as a nation, but we just aren't acting on, aren't proposing, aren't getting done, even though they're so unbelievable, like 80%, as I said, in the University of Maryland poll. And like what with Liam proposed with gerrymandering, I think we can say that most American citizens would not want gerrymandering. And the fact that these issues are not being dealt with, and that we're dealing with partisan issues, which we either get done and then they get reversed and then get done again, it makes me think that because these issues are under discussed, is that why we agree on them? Once they get into the limelight or the spotlight of issues in America, is that when they start to become partisan because you have different groups influencing people, lobbyists, that sort of thing? Or is it because we're just so focused on hating each other that we only focus on issues that the other side is against because we almost want to beat them in some sort of way?
Judge Nelson?
So I have a different question. The you know the story of the 27th Amendment. The college kid got a C because he proposed this amendment, and the professor said this is a horrible idea. So he went out and got it passed, and retroactively got his grade changed to an A. So I'm wondering, do you have any plans to take your amendments to go out and actually make this materialize into the 28th Amendment? And if so, how would you go about doing it?
Well, logically speaking, if two senators can't get it done, I don't know how a high school student's going to do it. But I also believe that you should never let go of your dreams and that you should keep pushing. And so I think that you need to get people talking about it. If it's really an important issue, get the media talking about it. Get politicians talking about it. Get activists talking about it. Get everyone talking about it. That's the only way it's going to get done. Because it seems like in our country, the only way an issue gets resolved is if we fight about it.
Yeah, I actually remember reading about that story when I was researching for the competition. And it turns out that he actually got he got an A+ on his essay, which was, they don't even give out A+s at, I think it was UT Austin. So he got the highest grade possible. And I think it was a really good story because it just shows how, when it comes to politics, it just feels like one person cannot make a difference because there are so many checks and balances and things that are involved in getting anything done in the government. But he was able to find a loophole and was able to just lobby politicians and was able to get it retroactively passed, even though it was proposed in, I think it was 1789, right? So if I was ever to think of trying to pass this amendment myself, I would definitely have to work with other people and have to just show people why I think the amendment must be passed in order to actually protect our democracy and not just stop an issue that a lot of people don't really like know about, but to actually connect it to their lives and to what happens in their districts, and how if we can actually stop gerrymandering, we can actually protect our principles of democracy and move our country towards an era that's focused less on partisan hostility and more just on be able to make concessions with each other. So I would definitely want to work with other people if I try to get it passed.
I think that's a great note to end on. That's very well said. Please join me in thanking our winners and our panelists. Before we adjourn, I wanted to thank a number of folks whose contributions were critical to making this year's contest such a success. First of all of us on the PICO committee owe a huge debt of gratitude to the circuit executive staff who are part of the committee and who expertly guide every stage of this contest from the early brainstorming through the creation of the topic to the judging right through to the program that we're having today. So to Renee Lorda, Catherine Rodriguez, Chandan Tor, all of whom have been here working hard while we've been going, Alex Claussen, Bill Craycraft, and Kari Kelso, thanks to each of you for everything that you do this year and every year to support this contest. It simply could not happen without you. I'd like to also thank Robin Lipsky, who's the executive director of the Ninth Circuit Historical Society, and Audrey Barrett of her staff for their characteristically excellent work curating and preparing the supporting materials for the contest website. In years past, I've said I wish that we could send a link to that to everyone in America because the materials are that good and give that much of a foundation on these civics issues that are part of the contest. Thank you again to Justice Kagan and to Chief Judge Murguia for sharing your insights with our winners and celebrating their success. I want to thank all of the teachers, family members, friends who encourage students to enter the contest and help them along the way. This is your day to celebrate too, and we're so glad to have you here to do that. And last, I want to thank all of the students who submitted essays and videos. The entries showed creativity, they showed thorough research, and they clearly were the product of a lot of hard work and focused thinking about the meaning of our Constitution and the role it plays in our country's communal life. You clearly really cared about expressing your perspective on this important topic, and it really showed. And so all those of us who do the judging at the district level right up until our winners, every year we are astounded with the quality of the submissions that we get, the quality of the thinking, the creativity, frankly, the production values and what you can do on an iPhone today that would be a TV station about a decade ago. And so it is always so gratifying for those of us who get the honor of being part of this contest to see the high quality of work that our young people are doing. And it's our pleasure to give them the opportunity to think about these important issues. And so with that, I want to thank everyone for joining us today, and we'll look forward to seeing everyone at next year's conference. Thank you.